worshiping with us for the first time, congratulations! You are most welcome into this great gathering. This is no coincidence. We believe that your steps were ordered by God and He has a plan for you. You are now a candidate of God's revival. We are a generation called to worship the one true God. We do this in spirit and in truth, in kindness and in love, preaching and teaching the Word of God by the power of the Holy Spirit. Here, your mind will be renewed as we connect you to God's presence, and you are now transformed into a giant of a strange order. Welcome home.
Yeah. What a wonderful day. This is another brand new day, new opportunity God has given to us to secure our claiming future. What you ever have is now. 2 Corinthians chapter 6 verse 2. He said, now is the acceptable time. Well, it is important for you to know how to maximize the present. Don't live in procrastination. What you got to do now, you do it now. What you do now is the prophecy of what your tomorrow will be. What you think now, what you say now, and what you do now shows exactly what you're going to get tomorrow. So now is the prophecy of your tomorrow. So make sure you maximize the time. The Bible says redeeming the time. Be circumspect with the time, because the days are evil. We are in perilous times. Perilous means difficult times. So you must understand it. And this is the best hour for God's children. The hour that God expects us to shine the brightest in the whole gloomy economy of men. We are not a social economy. Our economy is the kingdom economy. So Joel chapter 2 talks about thick darkness for this time. That is a time of gloominess. Malachi chapter 4 verse 1 talks about it is the time that burns like an oven. And Isaiah chapter 60 talks about darkness shall cover the earth and dark gross darkness the people. But the short thing is that the light of God, the glory of God is upon our lives. Light is not truly relevant except where there is darkness. So this is our finest hour. So if you are not yet in the kingdom of God, if you are not yet in the kingdom of light, this is the best hour to do that. Because your covenant of exemption is when you are in the kingdom of light, then you serve God. Then you shall be excluded from all these things. Because the Bible says in Malachi chapter 3, verse 17 and 18, that this is the time of God's jewels, when God has gone to gather to make up his jewels. Making up means whatever is losing in the lives of his own people. You add it up to make sure that their story is told in glory, to make sure that they enter into full-scale laughter. So this is the time of the jewels of God. And this is the time God says that he will spare his people as a man spareth his son that serves him. So service is our covenant platform for exemption from all the woes and caprices of these perilous times. That is the best hour for us. Verse 2 of Malachi chapter 3 said, the Son of Righteousness shall arise, okay, and on our behalf. That's all. You can be in the same environment with others, which are not going through what they are going through, because God is helping. God did same thing for the children of Israel. In the night, he was a pillar of fire. In the day, he was a pillar of light. So he was giving them direction, he was giving them protection, and all through. So that is what it ought to be with us. At all times, the presence of God makes a difference. So I congratulate you for being alive at a time like this. So we are talking again, very simple term, the viper of shame. Because the devil uses the weapon of shame, disgrace, humiliation against the children of God. You know, and they're using people to make them naked. Look at Aaron. Moses cried out, he said, Aaron, you have made the people naked. That is, you have put them to shame. No more covering. Anything can happen to them from the camp of the enemy. You have lowered the hedge. Ecclesiastes chapter 10 verse 8 says, when the hedge is lowered, the serpent can bite. When you're naked, then you have no covering. Anything can bite you. Okay? That's what shame. And shame is a viper. Okay? When Jesus looked at some people, even John the Baptist, he said, you brood of vipers. That is, in the physical, you are leaders, but in the realm of the spirit, you are a brood of vipers. So you have the viper of shame. And when the viper of shame stings you, it's not the sting that is dangerous, it's the venom of shame that comes out of it that really destroys. So a lot of people's image have been damaged. A lot of people have lost good help, good opportunities because of the viper of shame. And the viper of shame wants to gradually kill a person and to repackage the person for evil and to write the last chapter of the person's life on earth. And I pray for you today. The enemy, sickness, and all their likes can never write the last chapter of your life, because our Father is the author and is the finisher. He's the beginning, he's the end. He's the first, he's the last. So if he has begun a good thing, Philippians chapter 1 verse 6, say, he that began this good work in you shall finish it, shall perfect it unto the day of our Lord Jesus. So he will finish, he will start, he will finish. The devil will not finish what God has put in place. Psalm 138 verse 7, he said, God shall perfect all things that concerns you. You are still work in progress. So God is perfecting you, God is perfecting me. He's in the business of perfecting, and the devil cannot spoil our day. Every evil full of power, following you to spoil your day, to spoil the works of your hand today, I cut them off from you forever. Every monitoring spirit assigned to monitor you for evil today, I blindfold all of them and all their monitoring gadgets. I command them to scatter and die in the matchless name of Jesus. This is your finest hour, and today is actually, as you're listening to me, it's your covenant day of release. So I release your family, I release your home, I release your marriage, I release the works of your hands, I release your wealth, I release your family line, I release your father's house, I release your desperate helpers, your destiny helpers, from the whims and caprices of the enemy in the name of Jesus. I decree, according to Psalm chapter 7 verse 9, that the wickedness of the wicked comes to an end today in your life and in the lives of your loved ones in the matchless name of Jesus. You can never be a chief victim in the affairs of life. In the name of Jesus, you cannot be a scapegoat in the affairs of life. You can never be the dreg of this society. You can never be the footmat. Neither will you ever be the dustbin of this time and generation. In the matchless name of Jesus, I congratulate you because your best days are ahead. The true and authentic version of your life is manifesting right now. You shall end well. Ecclesiastes chapter 7 verse 8 says, better is the end of a thing than the beginning thereof. What it simply means is that you can start badly but end well. People will always remember you for how you ended. If you start good and end badly, that is disastrous. So you can stand badly but end well. Job chapter 8 verse 7. He said, though thy beginning was small, your later end shall greatly increase. That's the word of God for you. In other words, you must end well. And I'm praying for you. You will not only end well, you end well and strong. In the matchless name of Jesus. If Jesus tarries, posterity shall honor God that somebody like you passed through the sand of time. In the matchless name of Jesus. You shall not labor in vain. You shall not come to planet Earth in vain. Any power that wants your sojourn in planet Earth to be in vain. Today, I cut them off in the matchless name of Jesus. You shall not be cut off from the land of the living before your time. You shall fulfill your days on earth. Good old age is your portion if Jesus Christ tarries. In the matchless name of Jesus, you shall continue to bring fruit even in your good old age. According to Psalm chapter 92 verse 14, you shall continue to be productive, fruit-bearing, in all through your lives. In the name of Jesus, I congratulate you. I congratulate you in Jesus' name. I want to read from the Bible, Isaiah chapter 50, verse 6. Talking about Jesus, he said, I gave my back to the smiters and my cheeks to them that plucked off the hair. I hid not my face from shame and spitting. Jesus took the shame that we ought to take. So you are carrying shame now is a product of ignorance. Because ignorance robs God's people of what they ought to begin to enjoy as goodly inheritance in their kingdom. But once you can know what to do, and you do them, then definitely you will enjoy the result. Praise God. He took that shame, so you are not supposed to take it. That's why Isaiah chapter 61 verse 7 says, instead of shame, you shall have double honor. I release double honor upon you today. Instead of shame, you shall walk in double honor. I have come today to restore somebody's dignity, to restore somebody's destiny color, to restore somebody's beauty in the kingdom. And if you are the person, wherever you are, shout amen. Amen. Hallelujah. And I see God beautifying you. I see my God decorating you with all the decorations of heaven. And I see because of that, people will begin to hold on to you and say, take me to your God. Because they'll begin to see the evidences of the gospel in your life. Zechariah chapter 8 verse 23 will become alive in you. That your whole life will begin to testify of Jesus. Will begin to speak of Jesus. That people will say, please, 10 men who can be holding you per time. You have not talked to them yet, but your life, through your life, they are receiving the gospel. They will say, take me to your God. Take me to your God. What a joy that could be. And you begin to bring people into the kingdom, and God will bless you even the more. Whatever God gives to us, our lives, our resources, is meant for his kingdom. Zechariah chapter 1 verse 17. He said, true prosperity shall the kingdom of God, the city of God, be spread abroad. And that is what it is. And once you know this to be the real purpose for prosperity, you will never lack, because God is looking for men to bless, not men to use. Men, he will pass his budget through. He said, the silver is mine, the gold is mine. That's what he said. So he's not looking for your money to be rich or to be rich. He's already rich. You need him, but he pays. He cannot pay you if you're lazy. Amos chapter 6 verse 1 says, woe unto them at ease in Zion. But when you walk, the reward for hard work is more work. You keep working more, you keep getting more from him. He is a good paymaster. He pays the real good. John chapter 4 verse 36, he says, he that reapeth, receiveth wages. That's the way God does. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6, he says, he that comes to God must believe that he is, number one, and then he is a rewarder of them who diligently seek him. He rewards diligence. Excuse me. He's a rewarder anytime, any day. I pray you get into the reward system of God, because it's a system. You walk into it through service. Praise God. So we are talking about the viper of shame. Shame is a terrible weapon. Shame derobes you of every form of honor. Shame will make people to misunderstand you. Shame is humiliating. You must know that. Shame is disgrace. It's another word for disgrace. When you're talking about shame, you're talking about degradation. You're talking about demotion. You're talking about somebody being discredited. You're talking about somebody who is under, he is or she is being de-esteemed. You're talking about embarrassment. You are talking about terrible embarrassment, somebody suffering from terrible embarrassment. You are talking about scandal, you are talking about reproach. So when you are talking about shame, you are talking about unworthiness, failure to live up to a particular expectation. That is what shame is all about. You are talking about nakedness, somebody being made naked. I pray today that the viper of shame shall not have you as a candidate in the name of Jesus. I pray for you. That today is your covenant day of being released from shame, from reproach, from humiliation, from demotion, in the name of Jesus. I want to read, I took a case study today. Oh, there is somebody who is listening. Daddy said, you have suffered a lot of defeat. But beginning from now, you shall begin to experience some streak of successes in the name of Jesus. 2 Samuel chapter 9 verse 1. We are taking a case study of two guys. 2 Samuel chapter 9 verse 1. And I read. And David said, is there yet any that is left of the house of Saul, that I may show him kindness for Jonathan's sake? And there was one of the house of Saul, a servant, whose name was Ziba. And when they had called him unto David, the king said unto him, art thou Ziba? And he said, thy servant is he. Wow. And the king said, is there not yet any of the house of Saul, that I may show the kindness of God unto him? And Ziba said unto the king, Jonathan had yet a son, which is lame on his feet. And the king said unto him, where is he? And Ziba said unto the king, behold, he is in the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, in Lo Debar. Then the king sent and fetched him out of the house of Machir, the son of Amiel from Lodebar. Now when Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, was come to God, unto God, he fell on his face and did reverence. And David said, Mephibosheth. And he answered, Behold thy servant. Verse 7. And David said unto him, Fear not, for I will surely show thee kindness for Jonathan's sake, thy father's sake. And I will restore thee all the land of Saul, thy father, and thou shalt eat bread at my table continually. Now, it is interesting to notice that when they are talking about the name Mephibosheth, it means Meribah. That's another name for Mephibosheth is Meribah. And Mephibosheth means one who destroys shame. One who destroys shame. And you can see at the end of the day, his life destroyed shame. Life brought him into shame. And he was left in Lodebar. Lodebar is a place of destitute, those who want nothing, the rejects. So that was where life threw him. But one day, the viper of shame was destroyed over his life, and his status changed, and he ended. And if you watch the scripture, it's clinically clear. He said he was still lame. Look at that. He said, and thou shalt eat bread continually at my table. Verse 13 says, so Mephibosheth dwelt in Jerusalem, for he did eat continually at the king's table, and was lame on both his feet. By right, somebody lame ought not to be in the palace. Somebody lame ought not to be in the table. But God can suspend the rules of men to position you. And I see God doing that for someone here. He's setting protocols aside to position you, to give you that job, that scholarship, to give you that desired lifting. And I thank God for your life, that you are alive to listen to this today. Because as I'm speaking, some prophetic things are coming out to reposition you in the affairs of life. So you see, one is Mephibosheth. Let's look at the other one, that is Ishbosheth, in 2 Samuel chapter 4. Two people who want to study before we continue. Chapter 4 verse 5 says, and the sons of Rimmon the Berotite, Rechab, and Bana went and came about the heat of the day to the house of Ishbosheth, who lay on a bed at noon, and they came thither into the midst of the house, as though they would have fished wheat, and they smote him under the fifth rib, and Rechab and Bana his brother escaped. For when they came into the house, he lay on his bed in his bedchamber, and they smote him and slew him, and beheaded him, and took his head, and got them away through the plain all night. And they brought the head of Ishbosheth unto David to Hebron, and said to the king, Behold, the head of Ishbosheth, the son of Saul, thy enemy, which sought thy life, and the Lord had avenged my lord the king this day of Saul and of his seed. The name Ishbosheth means man of shame. Mephibosheth means one that destroys shame. So the man of shame died in shame. So you can see these two groups. Ishbosheth died in the hands of the enemy, like his grandpa and like his father. So these are two men. One Mephibosheth destroyed shame. One Ishbosheth, man of shame, man of sorrow, died disgracefully. Shame destroyed him. Shame can come from God, can come from man, can come from Satan. God can clothe men with shame. Satan is his weapon. So if you don't deal with it, it will bring you down. Acts chapter 28, that's where we'll look a little bit. Acts chapter 28. Acts of Apostles chapter 28. And if you know Acts of Apostles, it's supposed to be Acts of the Holy Spirit. And look at from chapter 1, you begin to see the Acts of the Holy Spirit in this last chapter, 28. And when he gets to the last chapter, 28, the devil wants to use the last chapter to rewrite somebody's history negatively. That is at the end of Acts of Apostles. After many great works done by this servant of God, the devil wanted to end it by writing the last chapter in shame. I pray that the devil shall not write the last chapter of your life in the name of Jesus. Shall not even write any line in the chapters of your life in the name of Jesus. Acts of Apostles chapter 28, I want to read from verse 1. And when they were escaped, then they knew that the island was called Melita, and the barbarous people showed us no little kindness, for they kindled the fire and received us everyone because of the present rain and because of the cold. And when Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and led them to the fire, there came a viper out of the heat and fastened on his head. And when the barbarians saw the venomous heat hang on his head, they said among themselves, "No doubt this man is a murderer, whom though he had escaped the sea, yet vengeance suffered not to live." And he shook off the beast into the fire and felt no harm. Verse 6, "Howbeit they looked when he should have swollen or fallen down dead suddenly. But after they had looked a great while and saw no harm come to him, they changed their minds and said that he was a god." In the same quarters were possessions of the chief man of the island, whose name was Publius, who received us and lodged us 3 days courteously. And it came to pass that the father of Publius lay sick of fever and of a bloody flux, to whom Paul entered him and prayed and laid his hands on him and healed him. So when this was done, others also which had diseases in the island came and were healed, who also honored us with many honors. And when we departed, they laded us with such things as were necessary. Beloved, we see here that Satan planned to end Paul's life disrespectfully, disgracefully. A viper of disgrace was hidden to kill him. Listen. Was hidden. Now notice that the viper didn't go for any other place than the hand. And the viper didn't disturb others who were not walking. Paul happened to the one who wanted to create a change, who wanted to walk, who was ready to walk, who went about walking, getting wood. Whereas these other ones were more interested in enjoying the fire. Those who are out to help humanity, to join with God, the devil always targets them. So don't be surprised if you are going through one affliction or the other because of what you are doing in helping humanity. Don't worry, it will turn out to your own testimony. That's what it is. It may not look like it at the beginning, but Romans chapter 8 verse 28 says, "For we know that all things work together for good, who are for those who love God and those who are called according to his purpose." So as far as you love God, your heart is with God, you are always on a mission to help humanity, then you get attacks, with all the attacks will promote you. That's the way it works. For that person over there, that sickness has been holding you down, wherever you are, be free from sickness, be free from sorrow, be free from tragedy, be free from disaster. In the name of Jesus, the devil shall no longer steal your blessings. In the matchless name of Jesus, all the places that Satan has put together against you, you shall jump and pass all those places in the name of Jesus. I pray for you now that everything that the devil has stolen against you, I recover them back for you in the name of Jesus. You begin to walk now in great freedom in the matchless name of Jesus. And any agent of the devil around you shall be uprooted in the matchless name of Jesus. Every tree of sorrow in your family line, I uproot such now in the mighty name of Jesus. It is well with your children. Your children shall not be used against you. Your children shall never be used against you. Your children shall never be used to bring you to shame. Your children shall never be used to derail your destiny. Your children shall never be used to bring you down. In the name of Jesus, no more sorrows for you. No more. In Jesus' matchless name, I pray that beginning from this hour, eternity is your portion in the name of Jesus. Now let me continue. The enemy was planning Paul's disgrace. And the devil wanted really to write the last chapter of his life because he was doing great with God. The devil planned, even the audience, he wanted to supervise his disgrace for Samson. Look at the people he planned for Samson, the Philistines, those who saw him carry the gate. Who do you carry the gate of the city? Those who knew that with one jawbone of an axe, he destroyed 1,000 of their soldiers. They knew the mighty works he did. And that's how they rendered him to a man that had no eyes. And he chose the audience to disgrace him. And it looks as if he succeeded. He died with his enemies. The devil is a bastard. He wants to do the same.